Professor Marchesini, Giulio is a good friend of us. I mean, it's a long-standing collaborator. And Giulio from the University of Bologna is going to speak about adults' nutritional problems. Giulio, 20 minutes.
Well thanks, Claudio, and thanks to you all for inviting me to this very challenging meeting. And I am also part of the group set in Bologna, who is specifically devoted to energy, which is called Energy for Italy. So I take care of the problem of the sustainable development of foods in this area, which is a sort of transition also, like the one which is from electric powered and combustion powered engines and so on. My main concern is that malnutrition affects all regions worldwide. We have a lot of differences in the world. We have billions of people who are overweight or obese, 600 million individuals who are obese around the world, and we have about the same number of people who is underweight. And this is the reason why we have so much differences around the world in terms of nutritional problems, which go from obesity to stunting, and children cannot grow up correctly. If we look at the daily supply of calories around the world, this is a map of what is the daily supply. You see that there are very large differences in the amount of calories which are distributed around the world, as well as we have differences in disparities in food consumption. That means that we have areas where the distribution of food is more or less regularly distributed with an error coefficient of variations, but we have areas where we have persons who are very obese and probably they eat much more than needed. And there are persons who eat much less than needed, so are stunting or are malnourished. I'm sorry for a few slides which do not show perfectly. And you see that I try to turn them into PDF, but it didn't work. And this is the other side of the coin, an insufficient number of persons who make sufficient hours of physical activity. And this is the other coin of the medal in terms of obesity. You see there are very, very large differences across the world. And this is the overall number of people who are obese around the world. We have scattered area where obesity is very, very high, and the colors are self-explanatory. I'm sorry for not showing correctly, but anyway, you see that areas more the most concerned areas are the Middle East countries and Egypt, where we have a lot of obesity. And this is an additional problem because most of these countries also have migrants to Europe, and they come to Europe where they immediately develop other diseases such as diabetes. And the century is not the 21st century, but it has also been named as the extra large century. And this is what is happening because of the amount of obesity around the world. This is the estimated annual death due to obesity taken from the global burden of diseases. And also in this case, you see that there are countries where we have no data, but we have many more data from other countries where the number of deaths attributable to obesity is extremely high. And as well as we have the estimated annual deaths for in terms of calorie supply, which is also quite different around the world. And all over the world, we have different patterns of nutrition. For example, the estimated per capita fruit intake is totally different around the world. And we have also a totally different average per capita dietary supply. And we have a total different consumption of meat around the world, which give rise to totally different patterns of malnutrition and around the world. There are a few points that I would like to stress. For example, what has changed during the last, I say, 50 years or so? And this is a picture taken also from our world in data, where the amount of daily and plant protein in different states is taken. And if you look at the amount of dietary protein of China, now it's around the same pattern, which is in most developed countries. But it was not like this in 1961, if I remember well, where the number of protein in China was almost from vegetable proteins. We had very, very few proteins for an animal meat. And if we assume that all over the world, every underdeveloped countries will move towards the Western pattern, the amount of proteins from both animal and vegetable sources will be absolutely unachievable by any food supply all over the world. And this is consumption of animal fats, which is also extremely different around the world. And this is the final one, the consumption of vegetal oils, which differs in terms of the different areas, or the consumption of sugar. There are countries where the consumption of sugar per capita is over 150 kilograms. And this means that we definitely eat much more than we need for our everyday life. And we have a few assumptions which are very well supported by scientific and literature evidence. One is that the Mediterranean diet is probably the best diet we could afford in order to reduce the burden of diseases across the world. And the Mediterranean diet is a diet which contains an amount of fat which is probably much more than what is dictated by a regulatory agency. For example, the American agency strive for having a much less content of fat, but the Mediterranean diet probably is the one which is mostly usable and can give rise to a lower number of deaths. And however, it is also difficult to implement in Western countries. And why I say that Mediterranean diet is the best, because it probably, as you can see here, is the diet which provides the lower or the most achievable weight loss in people who are obese, and the most sustainable weight loss, contrary, for example, to a low carbohydrate or a low fat diet, which have probably a higher impact in the short term, but are no longer sustainable in the long run. And we have a lot of data on the Mediterranean diet. This is the very famous Spanish experience of the Predimed trial, where they showed that the Mediterranean diet, either so supplemented by extra virgin olive oil or by nuts, is extremely effective in reducing the deaths, or the primary endpoint, which was a composite of acute myocardial infarction, stroke, or death from cardiovascular causes in the population. This is one of the very few studies which I know was interrupted by the ethical committee because of a striking advantage of the experimental diet versus the control diet. And the monitoring system imposed to stop the trials in order to avoid unnecessary deaths in the control population. However, the number of people who attain a Mediterranean diet is probably very different. And if we look at how things have been changing from 1990 to 2018, you see that in most countries, the adherence to the Mediterranean diet has colors which are definitely not in favor of a higher adherence in the population. We have to transform our food system in order to prevent non-communicable diseases. And this is a very, very challenging procedure. We have to take care of a lot of systems which are intimately connected with each other, which is food environment, which is consumer behavior, which is diet, which is the impact and the social, economic, and the environmental impact of the diet. And this is the reason why it is so difficult to advise people on what is probably best. And I am sure that you will focus on these problems in your attempt to validate all these challenging situation. One of the main problems is that the more we eat, the more we will develop diabetes. And diabetes is another of the conditions which will definitely impact on the survival of the population, on the burden of diseases of the population. This is a map of different countries, and we have an estimated of 536 million adults which are currently living with diabetes, but this number is expectedly to increase dramatically to over 600 million by 2030 and over 780 million in 2045. And the distribution of diabetes across the world is totally different. For example, we are expecting a very narrow increase of diabetes in a few areas. For example, Central Europe will increase by only 13%. We have to expect a very high rate of increase of diabetes in other countries. And one of the most challenging areas are Africa and the Middle East and North Africa, not to say India and other countries where these numbers will increase dramatically. And this is one also, these are areas where the possibility to cure diabetes is very far from the national health systems they have. And this will expose the population to a tremendous impact in terms of the burden of diseases. The other problem with obesity is the number of people who will develop a cardiovascular disease, which is another of the conditions we have to take care of if we wish to reduce the burden of diseases. And the positive energy balance gives rise to obesity, which causes cardiac steatosis, excess of visceral fat around the world, around the body, and the liver steatosis, which is something I take care of mostly. But we should not forget the inner risk of obesity in terms of the developing of cancer mortality in both men and women. We are very well aware, this is a very old study, it dates back to over 20 years, carried out in 1 million people of Americans, where they showed that the possibility to develop a cancer, and we have multiple areas where this applies, are all due to an increase in body weight and an increase in BMI. So we have to take care of the possibility that every obese or overweight person will ultimately develop cancer at rates which are much higher than in the normal population. This is the amount of men, this is the amount of women. You see that most bars are totally outside the linear of the line of indifference. So it's definitely a problem. What about the possibility to define a healthy diet all over the world? This is very difficult. We have a group of people involved in nutrition who have declined an optimum diet that would save approximately 11 million people every year. But if we look at how this diet could be implemented and what is the global average compared to what would be the best diet, we have areas which are definitely much more overconsumed respect to what should be done. And we have other areas, other groups of foods which are definitely underconsumed. And the daily income per person in terms of this healthy diet around the world would be about 41% of total budget, which is it's definitely too much to be sustained. And probably in North America, moving from a healthy diet to moving to the normal diet to a healthy diet would be definitely possible. But as you can see here, there are areas around the world where this would be absolutely unbearable in terms of cost. And so we need somebody who takes care also of the economic in consideration when planning a normal diet or best diet. This is something which does not add much to what you have already seen. It is that if we move from a 7 day beef meat diet to 2 days beef and 5 days vegetarian or to full vegetarian diet, we may save carbon footprint, water footprint, and also the ecological footprint of our diet. And we have data, for example, this scenario, which was studied by a group of English nutritionists in 2012 and was published in 2012, that is a reduction of livestock product supplies balanced by an increase in plant commodities, or scenario two, that is moving from beef and sheep meat to white meat, or scenario three, moving from white meat to plant commodities, would save an enormous amount of cardiovascular deaths, cancer deaths, total deaths, according to the scenario we choose. So we know that we could definitely implement the health of our population simply moving from one diet to the other. That data shows that possibly the best compromise for an optimum intake of carbohydrates is around 50%, but this is not what we are currently using in our diets to reduce obesity, for example. And we have, or in the normal population, we have persons who prescribe or trying to move people towards very unbalanced diets without any definite improvement in what they can do in terms of obesity. This is what, for example, a VLCD intervention and the very low diet may be implemented in people with diabetes, which definitely improves the number of persons who weight loss, but in the long term, it will never be able to be maintained, and the return, they may improve diabetes in the short term, they may even solve diabetes in the short term, people get rid of diabetes, but we must be aware that this sort of diets are definitely not bearable in the longer term. And dietary carbohydrate intake in cohort analysis, for example, the substitution of carbohydrate for animal protein and fat, you see that improves life expectancy in the population, and the substitution of carbohydrate for plant and protein fat may in some way be favorable, but definitely plant protein intake and fat intake were associated with different mortality rates. So we must be aware that we have to take care of how we modify our diet if we want definitely to improve the rates of our population. The other types of dietary intervention are still more difficult. For example, the massive carbohydrate restriction is one of the way, is one of the strategies which has been implemented to reduce obesity, and totally restriction of carbohydrate might be sustained in the short term. As you can see here, in the long term, it's definitely unsustainable. And the same is true if we look at other dietary regimens, for example, moving from low fat plus physical activity or a Mediterranean diet, low carb diet. We have definitely the idea that it's very difficult to sustain different diets in the long terms. And the same is true if we look at the intermittent fasting, which is something which is now very, very common in the Italian population, and alternate day fasting improves, leads to a moderate weight loss, but benefits on cardiometabolic health may be unsustainable in the long terms, or time-restricted eating, which is the last way we are trying to modify the personal behaviors. And all this attempt to modify the diet of the population seems to be quite unbearable in the long run. The problem is that if we look at what happens in the population, and I took Mexico City, we have been talking about yesterday of Mexico City. In Mexico City, the number more than 200,000 cars are added every year, and there are 3.6 million of cans of soft drinks which are drunk every day, and a lot of people who are moving with the metro, and the high density of the population, and the high use of street food, with a massive obesity in Mexico City. Mexico City is an enormous town, which is approximately 140 kilometers long. And if we look at the population, and this is what I fear, that there are very strict division, which is a part of population which is living well and probably is eating well, and a population which is not eating well, is not living well, and junk food. And this is the problem. We have to address the global syndemic of obesity and malnutrition together with climate change. And it's a very, very difficult task. And can diets be healthy, sustainable, and equitable? I don't know if it could ever be done in the future. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much, Giulio. That has been an excellent lecture. We're going to have questions at the end of the second presentation. The second presentation will be given by Claudio Maffei from the University of Verona. And please, 20 minutes. I should